little oyster opens up, and you ain't there. It's about consistent support. Throwing consistent support at young people. I was with my teacher this morning. Her name's Flora Russ, Miss Russ, interviewing her. And she keeps denying she helped me. That's how cool she is. So I didn't help you. So I just was there. I was consistent. And I realized in philosophy, it's not about pitying people, oh, you poor thing, you know, let me help you. She was just like consistent, you know? When she knew about my friend who passed away, when she knew I was in a duty, she said, Victor, I'll be here for you when you're ready to change your life around, but you have to do the work. So she was consistent with me. And she looked at me this morning, we were having coffee, and she started to cry. She goes, the first time ever I see her emotional, she says, I really did help you. No, I really did help you change your life. And she started crying. I got it on video. I wish I could have put it up. And then I videotaped, I was like, say it again. Here you go. Right? So if we're going to help people, let's help people. Let's be consistent. Let's grow as a community. Those of us that have historical memory of Oakland, and I don't claim to have it because some of you in here are veterans that have been here since the freedom struggles and before. Some of you have been here since the Great Migrations. And you know what I'm talking about. From the South to work in the industries. In the South of the United States, and now the Great Migration is from the South of Central America, right? So there's always migration here. And we come together as a community and we build. And those of you with the historical knowledge of Oakland know that Oakland is growing. A group of a critical mass of educated professionals that are about making a bright kind of change. And it's about getting together and not dividing ourselves, because we're still not, you know, a huge number. So it's a basic model, right? These at-risk young people that we demand that institutions, whether it's families, educated families, to treat them as if they're at promise, right? Police and schools, right? That we all come together and treat young people as if they're at promise. Yes, we hold them accountable, but it's a different model of doing business.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
It's about bringing them back in to the community, and that's what ultimately restorative justice is about. So, when I was a little kid, we used to, I don't even know where this free cheese came from. Remember the free yellow cheese, the big compliment? Government cheese. I remember waiting in line at the welfare line in North Oakland. You know that welfare line over there? North Oakland?
Yeah.
How many of you know about the North Oakland one? Yeah, okay, one of you. All right. Two of you. I remember waiting in line over there, and just all of a sudden we end up with this big block of yellow cheese. We were looking for like maybe a two-story house up in the Oakland Hills. But they gave us cheese. And you know what we do with this cheese?
Grilled cheese.
That's what you would do with it. Let me tell you what we would do with it. We go to the store, buy tortillas, and not give the money too short. We buy tortillas, and we would make quesadillas. So young people out there, middle schoolers, high schoolers, when life gives you cheese,
make quesadillas.
You make quesadillas. But on the real, what that means. Okay, all right. Let me be multicultural. Life gives you cheese, make grilled cheese sandwiches. Okay. This is about resilience. You know, we have this uncle, and he used to collect bottles, and I would help him. Because, you know, the aluminum cans everyone collects, so there's bottles at the restaurants. And the bottles would break. And I would go help him, and we would start bleeding. Our hands would start bleeding from sorting them, the broken bottles. And I'd be terrified, you know, and I'd stop working. And I'd look at him, and he's still working. And he's bleeding, and he's still working. He looks at me, and he says, "Mijo, estamos buscando vida." That's hard to translate. But a young man that I work with in L.A., who's facing 15 years to life, I told him this story. He goes, and he was African-American. I go, "Do you know what that means?" He goes, "Yeah, it's like making something out of nothing." That's the best translation I've gotten from people. Buscando vida, like seeking life, like surviving, making something out of nothing. And if we are experts at one thing, is making something out of nothing. And you're going to tell me that my culture, that these young people's culture, is a culture of poverty, a culture of violence, a culture that doesn't value education? It's a culture of resilience.
Yep.
It's a culture of grit, yep, of survival, of making something out of nothing, of buscando vida, and we have to be cultural translators for them. And we have to hold institutions accountable to also translate for them. At the end of the day, it's about dignity. If we can enhance young people's dignity, we're going to get far. But if we systematically strip them of their dignity, it's not going to work. So we have to enhance young people's dignity to prevent crime, violence, health-compromising behaviors, and to start the process of transformation. It worked for me. It worked for Randy. It's working for young people that are changing, that someone reached out to them and gave them a sense of dignity and humanity and let them know that we do care for them as a community. Yep. That we'll stand up for them, and that we will learn from them about their resilience and translate for them how to use that in the conventional world. Thank you very much for your time.
By sharing the stories that are in you. But for right now, what we have are two mics set up.
One mic.
One mic set up over there.
Yeah.
Okay, let's get into it. Stay for the performance segment. We would really love to see you.
So, I want to introduce Bass Piece up again.
Questions
and answers. I'm sorry.
So if you have questions, you can just line up at the mic over here if you have any questions for Dr. Rios.
That's my friend. She was at one of my presentations recently. I remember you. Hey, where was it? What presentation was it?
Santa Rosa?
No,
Walnut Creek.
Walnut Creek, don't tell them I've been in Walnut Creek.
Near Concord, near Concord.
Okay, my name is Mary Valcourt, and I'd like to know what we're doing to end the school to prison pipeline. Because I'm tired of teaching kids resilience to deal with a system that eats it out of them to begin with. There are 5 major programs in California that have been blocked. The wonderful Career Academy program that gets every kid to learn through careers. When UC took it over and started giving kids college prep to learn through careers, in came No Child Left Behind, which had some good parts, by the way, But put those kids in an extra period of English, an extra period of math, and no career by my kids. So all the kids that wanted to be mechanics dropped out. Okay, we've had a wonderful bilingual education, dual immersion, gets all kids to gifted education in K months. As soon as those test scores hit, gifted education guns came along. Lori Olson, one of the top ESL researchers in the nation, came out with a new thing for little kids, the SEAL program. Bilingual test scores hit, boom, all of a sudden Sierra Lamar was kidnapped. There has been intimidation, there has been violence, there have been kidnappings to keep these programs blocked. Linda Darling Hammond, she got to be the spokesperson for Obama, got on TV, had an academy leadership program to teach all principals how to deal with at-risk kids effectively, get all kids effective education, not just teachers of high kids. Boom, their test scores were discredited. And in Eastside San Jose, Iowaki's QTEL program and two of my programs were blocked by test score sabotage. They told the whole state these programs don't work. They blocked it themselves and then blamed it on us. There is systematic blocking of the programs for these students to begin with. And it's got to be recognized and stood up and stopped. We shouldn't have to teach these kids resilience and grit. We should do our best job to give them the best we got coming in the door. We shouldn't have to ask them. They come with culture, they come with language, they come with pride, they come with families. And so I'd like to know
the question,
what you'd like to do to support that.
I got the question. This is a very important debate that you bring up. And it's a debate we have in the community, and it's like, do we sort of fight at a grassroots level to change the system structurally because it's messed up? Capitalism is messed up. You know, this is why, you know, our children are suffering, because there's no viable jobs, right? Because the welfare system was dismantled in 1996 by a Democratic president, Bill Clinton, because we're not investing in infrastructure, because we're investing more in prisons than we do in public education. But if I continue to stress out about structural violence, and capitalism, I'm going to go into a spiral of depression. I'm just going to hide somewhere and cry myself to death. So on a day-to-day basis, right, as we find movements to change the system in a long-term plan, right, or even change policy, and there's some orgs in Oakland that are doing great work that on a quarterly basis are pushing the state capitol to change specific policies related to juvenile justice. George Valvies has been involved in that. Courage. Anyone else has been involved in that? Raise your hand. No? Okay. But they're on a quarterly basis, right, pushing, advocating, and making changes in juvenile policy and reform at a political level. My point is that let's have a two-tier strategy. One is changing the system radically, altering it, utopia, right? Imagining that another world is possible, and at the same time, on a day-to-day basis, working at a very micro level to change one heart at a time, and that's how we'll persist.
Good afternoon, Dr. Rios. I'm an educator over at LPS, and I believe some of our students are going to come visit you. We're excited to have that. I read a book by Falter, How Children Succeed, and he talks about grit and these things, but he comes at it from a different angle, from the KIPP model, from folks studying at this university level. How do we instill grit in young people? What is your take on the grit movement? It seems like character education is like coming back. We're kind of moving towards this grit model. Is it the same thing that you're talking about? And if it's not, where do you think they got it wrong?
I think that it's definitely being grit, resilience, restorative justice is being co-opted. People are making a lot of money off of it. People are making careers off of it. At the end of the day, it comes down to that traditional model of it takes a village to raise a child, holding people, everyone accountable for their actions. I'm talking about authority figures, holding police accountable, holding teachers accountable, holding parents accountable, holding
community workers account and the children themselves, right? And so for me, the way I look at the model is, I'm not going to go out there and tell young people, hey, the system is completely against you, therefore, you know, like the assumption is, don't do anything about, you know, like there's nothing you can do about it. I'm going to show up and say, like Martin Luther King Jr. said, he said, it might not be your fault that you've fallen on your face, but it's your responsibility to pick yourself back up, right? And so we have to balance that conversation between teaching pull yourself up by the bootstraps mentality, which grit can lean towards if we're not careful, right? And then also beating young people up with this idea that the system's completely against them, right? So for me, it's about finding that balance. And some people, you know, I don't want to say that my program has it right or my philosophy about it has it right, but the way I approach it, again, is to try to transform a young person's heart at a time. And then the next level, and this is critical, with these wonderful poets, youth organizers that are here for the political conscience, multicultural education, ethnic studies, connected to it, so that they then become critical change makers, so that they go out and advocate to change the system.
Mm-hmm. Good afternoon. Patrick Caceres, manager of the Oakland Citizens Police Review Board. Your story is very personal to me as a graduate of UC Berkeley and also as an individual that's made quesadillas out of government cheese. So, you know, thank you for your personal story and connecting with the young people here. My question is, you know, there's a lot of young Oakland police officers that are joining the academy and the city's continuously trying to recruit and get more police officers. What should we be teaching these new police officers about the youth in Oakland and for them to keep in mind as they try to do and interact with community policing for them?
Yeah, so I think we should teach police grit. You know, like we're all like, teachers tell me, like, I go, you know, talk to teachers, they're like, oh, these kids need emotional intelligence education. I'm like, oh, you need emotional intelligence education, lady. And it's like, you know, they don't like it when I say that. But we all need emotional intelligence education. We all need character development. We all need grit. Because at the end of the day, police officers have a stressful job. Teachers have a stressful job. And at the end of the day, they need to know how to handle themselves and ground themselves when it's time to make critical decisions, like not shooting a young black man that's out of a handcuff, or, you know, not calling the police on a boy that threw a spitball at you. You know, it's important for us to build resilience and grit in institutional actors as well, and not just young people, because then we're just putting all the weight on them. So I think, like, Malcolm Gladwell's work, you should read that. He does a lot of research on this. He talks about how cops could be retrained from going to 80% shooting a black man to like 20%, which is the natural curve of error for shooting anyone. Now, I know it's now we're talking about this language, but it's important, right, that we retrain everyone. You know, multicultural education shouldn't just be for our children, it should be for everyone.
Hi, thank you for being here, and I actually, well, first, my name is Rosa Torres, and I follow Noel Gallo in that I'm on the school board, District 5, first term, first year down, 3 years ago, and for me, when I heard the first speaker talk about the different programs being cut, as a criminal defense attorney in the court with 99.9% people of color arrested, regardless of the percent of the population, it made me sick year after year as an attorney. But the people in Sacramento are the ones who are controlling the budget. The people in Sacramento, the state education, all of those people in the office are the ones who can change the budget to prison, the budget to schools, the budget for mental health. So getting
people in this room and the people that they associate with elected to local, state, federal. That to me is how we stop cutting the programs that are working 100% graduation. Curtis Acosta in Arizona is at this ethnic study program. 100% graduation, they deem it anti-American. So that's for me the answer, right? Who's controlling that policy? But my question for you is when you had the triangle, the triad up there of school, police, and family, as a school board member, for me, what I'm trying to understand, you know, change in the school district is so slow, right? Great people, small percentage. Then the masses, just kind of asleep at the wheel maybe, because the system's been that way for so long. But the families is what I want to understand. What can you offer me as I meet with families, students, immigrant populations, here in Oakland, especially in my District 5, I have the most, well, everybody always says I have the most diverse schools. They're all very diverse, 60 languages spoken, so on and so forth. So how can you offer me some advice about working with the parents who often tell me, I can't control my son, he's bigger than me now, he wants to smoke weed all day and watch TV and not go to school. I can't make him go to school. My mother couldn't make me go to school, I dropped out in 9th grade. And I said, you can't make me go to school, Mom. You have 3 jobs, so your ass can't make me go to school because I'm staying right here and I watch TV all day. I'm an attorney now, but I have that history too. So the fact is, she can't make me go to school. And my clients tell me the same thing. I can't make Neil go to school because he's so big. He can hit me or he can beat me up. So help me understand how I can work with families in my term to make them stand up and push the kids.
A ver, hay familias aquí, papás, que son invitados como padres, no como profesionales, como padres. There's part of the answer right there. So are there families here that you were invited as a parent to show up to this? There's part of the answer. We need, as a community, to have forums like this, of course not so academic, maybe don't bring a college professor to talk to us. For real. To work with them at their level. We'll feed them, you know. How many of you got to go to summer camp growing up? Raise your hand. Wow. You guys are like middle class Oaklanders. Man, I never got to go to no summer camp. Actually, I don't know anyone that did growing up. But you see, my point is this. When you go to summer camp, because I experienced it with my daughters. You know, they go to summer camp. I have 13-year-old daughters, beautiful little girls. They look just like their daddy. Just kidding, they look like mom. And they go to summer, and they're just like, elated, their minds are transformed, they're thinking, you know, big, big thoughts about changing the world and feeding the homeless and going into, you know, like it's refreshing them. And that's what we did with Great Rewinds. We brought these youngsters out to the boats course, we exposed them. We can't take our children to summer camp because it's too expensive, and let's bring summer camp to them. Mm-hmm. Right? And it's the same with our parents. We can't take them somewhere, then we bring it to them. And it's important for us to take serious parent education that is about quality time spent with parents. Because at the end of the day, teachers can't control kids. Cops can't control unruly kids, right? They just can wrestle, but they can't control them. So at the end of the day, it's about us knowing that we just have to plant seeds into children, and that when they're ready, like the lawyer, right? In you was ready, not at 17, because you were watching novellas. What were you watching?
Gilligan's Island.
Gilligan's Island. My bad. My brother walks Gilligan's Island all the time. And I'm like, put on cartoons. Shut up and watch Gilligan's Island. And so you're watching Gilligan's Island, and little did you know you would one day be a prominent lawyer. and a prominent member of the Oakland political community, and we didn't know when that seed was going to grow, when it was going to sprout. You know, my other brother, he didn't change his life around it until he was like 26. 10 years on the streets, addicted to everything, just doing bad stuff, in and out of jail. And it took 10 years of us struggling with it. And it clicked. You know, we never know when it's going to click. And that's important to teach parents, law enforcement, teachers, all of us to learn. It's not about making people click, right? It's about letting people know that we're there for them when that light bulb turns on.
Hi, my name is
Christy Silver. I'm sorry, I don't want to cut you off. For the last couple of people that have questions, if you can keep it really short and concise, we're running short on time, so if you can cut straight to the question, please do, because we're running short on time. Thank you so much.
Oh, you know what? I forgot I have a flight out of San Francisco at 6 p.m., so I still got time.
I'm a service provider for Upper Bound and Educational Talent Search here in Oakland. I have students who've been shot walking off my program. I have students who face racist comments from their teachers every day. I have students who are constantly harassed by the teacher, by the police, by the people who they've been told. Are there support networks? How do I support my students when they come in and they can't even do their homework? They come in to us to do their homework, they come in to get help, and I'm a tutor and service provider, and instead, I mean, very gladly I've become kind of a mentor and counselor for these students, but, you know, there's so much more that they need, and how do I, as someone who's trying to work with Oakland Youth and who goes into high schools and works with these students one-on-one, how can I help or provide resources to students who are already so resilient and are basically just trying to survive? What can I do to help my students themselves?
Hmm. Wow, that's a question that's way bigger than me, but it's not bigger than the people in this room, right? And I think that it's going to take a community conversation to answer that. And I actually asked my teacher this morning that same question, what advice do you have for young teachers? And she said two things. She said, be consistent, and then she said, don't leave the teaching profession too early. So that's from her. And I'm sorry that it's incomplete, but it will take community conversations to really answer that.
Oh, I'm sorry to cut you off again, but we're just going to take one more question. We're really short on time. We have to be out of this space at 4, so we're going to take one more question so we can move on to the next piece. I'm so sorry.
Hi, my name is Christine Gurchak. I'm a PhD candidate at Berkeley, and I'm a psychologist trainee at Juvenile Hall in Contra Costa County. I like what you said about dignity. At Contra Costa County, one thing we're doing is having the young residents on our 8 units prepare letters advocating for what they want the federal government to do in response to President Obama's My Brother's Keeper initiative. So I was wondering, what are your hopes from that initiative, since he's bringing awareness to this issue?
Yeah, you know, at first I was pessimistic about it, but then I've been learning a lot lately that policy from the top down is not the only solution, but it does support the people that are trying to focus on these initiatives. So there's been a lot of grassroots and even statewide initiatives on boys and men of color, and for it to now be supported from the top down, I do see some hope. I do see that programming, particularly related to empowerment, learning about the sort of the right way of proving one's manhood, right? So if there's such a thing, right? But like being like a feminist male, right? So those kinds of programs, right? And then multicultural, you know, ethnic studies, education for these different boys and males of color. So I see some hope from the top down. The trickle down is always real, you know, real skim, but I definitely see that there is hope to really creating these small empowerment communities and circles like the Harlem Children's Zone and see more of those coming. I see the pendulum swinging. I see restorative justice really making, it's gonna be a slow swing. It's been swinging really slow. But I'm telling you, now I'm an outsider, unfortunately, of Oakland. Every time I come back, I see more vibrancy, you know, more action, more organizers, more intellects from the community, and that really, really inspires me. So, you know, I don't want to say that the change is happening now, but I do see it coming. Thank you all very much.
Hello. So good afternoon, everyone. Could I have the Bay Peace Youth assemble up on stage? My name is Tatiana. Thank you, Dr. Rios. Thank you so much. I hope you can stay.
I will stay. I'm
part of this. I work with an organization, all of us work with an organization called Bay Peace, Better Alternatives for Youth. My background is actually in restorative justice and bridging theater arts and creative expression. And what we're about to do is a creative segment that will integrate stories from you as community members, as educators, as parents, as youth, as soldiers in this struggle. What it is, since we don't have a lot of time, is going to be a sampler, a little sample of a bigger initiative called the Oakland Listening Sessions, where politicians and those who are running for elected office will have an opportunity to witness and listen from community members, specifically around violence, both in the community and by the state, and what those connections are. They're called the Oakland Listening Sessions, and the way that we are going to elevate these stories from the community is through creative arts, theater of the oppressed, playback theater, some storytelling, and spoken word. So I first want to introduce my amazing team. You've already met
Teela John.
And I will pass it over to Teela John, who is going to facilitate something called fluid sculptures. How many artists do we have in the room? How many actors? How many performers? I see some familiar faces, and what's exciting about this beautiful auditorium at Castlemont is that it's huge. And usually we're not performing in front of such a large group. One of the things we do is train in public speaking, feeling comfortable with ourselves, coming into our own bodies, embodiment, physical work, through our stories and what's alive for us right now. So inspired by Dr. Rios' presentation and inspired by our own lives and struggles, we are going to represent some stuff back to you. Just maybe one or two folks from the audience, since we don't have a lot of time. So here you go.
Alright, cool. So I'm going to explain what's about to happen. We got like 15 minutes, so it's going to happen quick. And I want to say, folks were like tripping out and stuff, and Victor Rios had, you know, used his time all the way up to 4, they'd still be here. They got busy lives apparently, right? But the folks that are still here, it's important that y'all are here, because how many, like, we all came to like see or listen to Victor Rios speak. But like, how often do we come to hear our community, like folks that aren't the ones that are on the podium, you feel me? And so like with babies, like what we want to do, whatever we do, it's important to us because we get our audience and our community engaged with what we do. So I'm going to invite y'all up here to come and talk to me and the rest of everybody else about what came up for you when Victor Rios was speaking. Takeaways, and if you have a story to tell that came up while you were listening to his speech, please share that with us because we all think that that storytelling is also important. So a hand if somebody's feeling particularly inspired.
What was the question?
If something came up for you while Victor was speaking, you have a story to tell, something you want to share with the audience, please come and share that with us up on stage.
Up on stage.
A free book for this
young lady right here. Who been the first person to come up. Can I get your name?
Mikayla.
Cool. Have a seat right here, Mikayla. So what's about to happen is Mikayla, I'm going to talk to her. She's going to tell me what came up for her, her story, whatever it may be. And our babies, young folks are going to listen, and they're going to play that improvisationally what they heard for them. So we got like the verbal storytelling, but then we're also going to have the visual storytelling for you all too. So clap it up for Mikayla. So Mikayla, what came up?
So when Dr. Rios was talking about making decisions I was thinking about the different things that my mom did to make that happen when I was a kid. And he also said that when, did you ever go to summer camp? No, we didn't go to summer camp, but my mom would take a big trash can and fill it up with water every morning during the summer. And they'd go swimming in the trash can. And my sisters and I would line up outside of the trash can, and we would all pretend this was like a swimming pool. We even had little goggles. And we'd get so excited, it's time to go swimming, and after the water heated up, and we'd put on our swimming suits and our goggles and take turns, I don't know what we were doing in the trash can, we weren't swimming, but we would call it swimming. Let's go swimming. And we were swimming in the trash can, but it was that was my summer camp, and I didn't realize that we were actually not swimming. So, that just reminded me of something that my mom did to change. That was something to look forward to. And so it was my summer, you weren't saying it ironically, let's go swimming. It wasn't ironic. You really thought you were swimming. We weren't. I still don't swim that well. Don't put me in the ocean. I'm afraid to go to the deep end of the pool because I'm used to swimming in a trash can. So I used to tell people I would go swimming. That's kind of ridiculous when they're saying, where is that? Where would you go? No, we would just fill up the trash can with water. But when I told people that later, they were I would love to. It's funny. It wasn't ironic. It's just, so I don't know. I appreciate that my mom did a lot of things like that to give us the experience of, I guess I was a little delusional after that about what swimming actually was. So, maybe it confused me a little. But at the time, that was my happy call.
Yeah, I'll
repeat the
question.
Oh, yeah, so I said my mom, and she's here. And I would say thanks for thinking fun ways to make our childhood special, and a lot of it led to great confusions in my later life about what was normal, it also led to having, I suppose, unique stories to tell and special memories.
Thanks for sharing. That was a beautiful story. Maybe some folks are not really prepared and equipped to do this?
Yep.
All right, cool. One at a time. If you can let us know what's good out for y'all.
No summer camp for me, but I can still have fun. No summer camp for me, but I can still have fun.
Mom, you taught me how to create my own happiness. Mom, you taught me how to create my own happiness. Mom, you taught me how to create my own happiness. Mom, you taught me how to create my own happiness. Mom, you taught me how to create my own happiness. Mom, you taught me how to create my own happiness. Mom, you taught me how to create my own happiness. Mom, you taught me how to create my own happiness.
By making the childhood special.
Campar. Mija, esta bota la basura. Campar. Mija, esta bota la basura. Campar. Esta bota la basura. Mucho
antes. Freeze. So, when I bring the mic to you, I want you to repeat repeat your sound and movements to everybody so that we can hear you two times more, okay?
I don't have a lot, but I'll give you this. I don't have a lot, but I'll give you this.
Look, I found nothing. I made something. Look, I found nothing. I made something.
No summer camp for me, but I can still have fun. No summer camp for me, but I can still have fun.
Mom, you taught me how to create my own happiness. Mom, you taught me how to create my own happiness.
Campana, ¿qué? Ahí está botando la basura. Campana, ¿qué? Ahí está botando la basura.
By making a child a special, can you create a big dream? By making a child a special, can you create a big dream?
Can we clap it up for you? Can you share with us what stood out to you the most from this little presentation?
Your comment, I mean, the way you moved, that was just awesome. But I don't know what other people do this, I think, right? That's like exactly. My mom was constantly saying, I don't know what. And then she has, you know, she fills that in later like, or something. Like, I don't know how I can help you, but I'll do this.
Also,
I don't
understand yourself,
also. I don't know exactly what you said.
You want to share what you said,
Doctor?
What I said was that.
Camping?
Oh, yeah. It was like a mom telling you, like, what? Like, you want to go camping? No, just come up here.
Beautiful. Can I ask you, Tatiana, why you chose to do what you did?
Oh, what I did was I cherry talking to our mom.
What were you saying?
You taught me how to create my own happiness. I wanted to step in as a mom and be like, I don't know what to do, but I'm going to give you this. And I'm not sure if this was maybe love, maybe what my understanding of community was. I wanted to feel in the mom's voice because all of these pieces were kind of relating to her. And then just thinking about mothers in our society.
Beautiful. Can we clap back to everybody up here? So
let's bring Alberto up to the stage. And one of the reasons this is so beautiful, we don't have a chance to interview everybody up here, but it's kind of this mutual sharing back and forth. So we have a teller that is sharing something deep and vulnerable, and then we have performers who are picking pieces of that story. But the reason that they pick a particular element is because they're coming from their own background. Something resonated, something popped off in their head from their own history. And so it's this kind of creative way of mutual sharing and exchange, and I just believe in this so much. And if we had more time, we'd maybe even build a scene based off of these fluid sculptures. But yeah, let's hear our reflection.
Yeah, so this is what came up for you. So for me, what came up was when Dr. Rios was talking about politicians being behind them, a lot of this idea of the fear of crime. And when I was coming to this event, I didn't know that Noel and Gallo was going to be here, so it was kind of confusing to me that, you know, we have this politician who's, you know, been pushing a lot for this gang injunctions and youth curfews. So that was the first thing that came to mind, and then also brought, you know, memories of me. One of my memories of when I got pulled over by the police was I'm a graduate from UC Davis. I'm a teacher in East Oakland, approved for Oakland High School, and at Rios High School. But when I was getting ready to graduate, and my mom, she works in Sacramento, and I was leaving Davis for my car, and they had just passed that cell phone law. And I was pulling into my mom's work, and I was like 15 feet away from parking, and I called my mom, hey mom, I'm outside. Because she had my graduation gown that was mailed for her, so I was going to her work to pick it up. And as I looked in my rearview mirror, I see the sirens going. And so as my mom is coming out to give me a graduation gown, she sees me, you know, getting criminalized. Here I am at UC Davis graduate, and I'm getting, you know, a citation in front of my mom's work. And so I just keep on thinking about this fear that's being created, you know, that's being pushed behind these laws.
Yeah.
I think we should get a little more.
Yeah.
There's a couple people.
Well, how about in, just what's your reflection on that experience?
That was like the, I just had never felt that I was subhuman until that moment when, that was like my first time being pulled over, and my mom had to be there to witness it. And not only my mom, but also her colleagues. You know, there's lots of windows in this office, and here I am in this officer. You know, she doesn't know the context behind my situation. And that's like when we were explaining about this criminalization of youth, you know, there's not a lot of context. I could be arrested in certain cities, like in Sacramento and West Sac, that have a youth curfew dating judges. I could be arrested for wearing red shoes and for walking out, like, you know, past certain hours.
How can we, this is like a question for you, Indiana, so how can we make that context clear? How do we discover ways so that folks understand that context? So they approach situations in a way where they care about the context before they start taking certain actions. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. I mean, I guess it's, you know, instead of just going straight into the punishment, you could ask, you know, why? Why was I on the phone? You know, I said, oh, I just, you know, wanted to get my mom real quick. I didn't want to bother. I'm just trying to put my graduation down. But she didn't care why I was on the phone. Like, there's no reason, you know, no care for, you know, my person or my actions, what I was doing at that particular time. So I think there should be maybe more push for, like, care for, like, why is this person out? And, like, why are they doing the things that they're doing? You know, trying to look at the root issue.
Thank you. I agree with you. I've got another question. Stay with. Y'all, I want to hear.
You're worth nothing! We can throw you out right now, today!
The system is made to bring us down.
You're worth nothing!
We can
throw you out right now.
The system
today.
Is made for us to
You're worth nothing!
Down, but we're gonna strive to make it.
The system is made to push us down, but we're
going
to
try
to make it.
I didn't do
nothing. The system is made to push us down, but we're going to try to make it. You're worth nothing. We're going to throw you away today. You're worth nothing.
Freeze.
We need to go get him.
So we're going to break this down again.
The system is made to push us down, but we're going to try to make it. The system is made to push us down, but we're going to try to make it.
I got these new red shoes. Fuck, how'd you tell me? I got these new red shoes. Fuck, how'd you tell
me? You're worth nothing. You're trash. We can throw you away right now, today. You're worth nothing. We can throw you away right now.
Well, I grew up in Oakland, so I feel like
Thank you for sharing that. That's powerful. I appreciate it. Can you clap it up for the ladies? Can you clap it up for the ladies?
Thank you, thank you. Hello?
Hello.
Hi, my name is Noel. So I know we're closing out right now. We have a summer training program where we get to play with all of this anger, aggression, frustration, hurt, pain, all the stuff that's inside of us that we aren't able to channel always. Like what Dr. Rios was saying, we go to unhealthy behaviors, we don't have the outlet, the avenue. We're one of the groups out there. There's tons of other people in this audience. I see friendly faces, people who are making positive change and difference. So we've got information out there. Thank you all for sticking around. And clap it up again. Let's start.
Let's give a round of applause for Dr. Rios. We appreciate him coming out to meet us today. And now give all of yourselves a round of applause for coming out and supporting PUEBLO and the work that they're doing. But you're not done yet. You're not done yet. So, the work that PUEBLO is doing, the work that Oakland Youth Policy Builders are doing, the work that Babies is doing, is only a start to what we're trying to accomplish. We need all of you here today to get involved and become a part of Babies and become a part of Oakland Youth Policy Builders. We currently have positions available for young people to become a part of Oakland Youth Policy Builders. You can sign up at the table outside in the foyer, and also you can sign up for Babies. I think that they have a sign up out in the foyer as well, where you can sign up. Also, there's a great work happening. PUEBLO is currently doing a fundraiser to bring restorative justice to Oakland youth. So if you all are on the peopleunited.org, find a link to their Kickstarter campaign to raise funds so that they can have a restorative justice program at PUEBLO and to support the work of PUEBLO. PUEBLO is also working on the Police Accountability Commission. If you all want more information about that, you can sign up to find out more about that, because it's going to take all of us to create a better community. And so we need all of your support, all of your help, any way that you can to push this work forward. Thank you, everybody, for coming out today and supporting the work of PUEBLO and Bay Peace. Give yourselves a round of applause. You all have a great evening. And yeah.